I got loyalty, got royalty inside my DNA. Cocaine quarter piece, got war and peace inside my DNA. I got power, poison, pain, and joy inside my DNA. I got hustle, though, ambition, flow inside my DNA. I was born like this, and sworn like this, immaculate.
Cool. So we will start. Hi, everyone. Welcome to this very dramatic episode of PL Talk. This is our most dramatic episode yet because we have never had a anything off before, let alone a great metaprogram off. So for all of you who don't understand what metaprogramming is, I'm not going to tell you right now, but you'll understand by the end of this episode. So you have to watch until the very end. There's a lot of suspense. You're not going to understand until the very end. And metaprogramming is a very dramatic programming concept in itself because it could really blow your mind. You know, there's so much you can do with it. And then one thing that when we brought up the concept of doing an episode on metaprogramming, Hongyi was like, well, how do we teach like metaprogramming across all languages? So that's when the idea of the metaprogram off came about. So now unfortunately either Quinn or Sam have to die or some Twitch version of it. But for anyone who isn't familiar with PL Talk, this is a weekly live stream on Fridays. It's usually 3 p.m. Pacific, but today it's earlier because Sam lives in the East Coast. And we have the mission of making programming languages topics more accessible to the every programmer. The hosts are Hongyi and me. So I am formerly a PL academic. That's how I know Sam. And now I am a founder and CEO of a company called Akita Software, where I'm making API observability better, but using PL topics, which we'll talk about someday. And Hongyi, do you want to introduce yourself? Then we'll introduce the meta program offers.
Yeah, I'm Hongyi Hu. I'm the self-confessed PL amateur. I don't know if I can still say that, but I'm the other half of the PL Talk hosting crew.
We've taught Hongyi so many things about PL. We need to do like the show about something else now.
But yeah, it's great to have the two of you here.
Yeah, so we'll give, I guess, brief intros of the two contestants. So Quinn Wilton is an Elixir enthusiast. Quinn tweets a lot about Elixir, and Quinn is obsessed with Elixir's macro system. Quinn
believes. Funny lately.
Yeah, Quinn believes it is a superior system to all other systems. But then to counter Quinn, we have Sam. Sam is a professor at Indiana. Sam is a core developer on Racket. So obviously he has some allegiances. He has devoted his entire life, the way monks devote their lives to like scribing things. Sam has devoted his life to Racket, and he spends a lot of time on Racket macros. So today we have a series of challenges. They will progress, and then Hongyi will be responsible for making the verdict: who will live and who will die.
Wow, that's heavy.
Yeah. So round one is gentle introduction to macros. Wait, Hongyi, you have to come up with a mechanism to decide whether Quinn or Sam goes first, because this is really dramatic.
Oh, I guess we can roll a die. Or I guess I can flip a coin. Doesn't Google have some kind of coin flipping thing?
It's very Someone dramatic. Dun, 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 dun.
I feel like when we show you our macros, you should just give us a solitary thumbs up or thumbs down.
Yeah.
Okay, someone call odds or evens.
Odds.
Okay. I have a 10, so...
Dun, 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 dun.
So, I will begin. we who are about to metaprogram salute you. So, hi, everybody. I'm Sam, and I'm going to be showing off metaprogramming in Racket. And let's get started.
Dun, 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 dun.
Dun, dun, dun.
Quinn, the chat is, I think the chat is favoring Sam right now. I don't know. You should,
I think I just recruited a bunch of
favoring Sam a little bit here too.
Minions to the chat. So here we go. We're going to be programming in Racket, and we're going to start writing our metaprograms. The basic idea of metaprogramming is that it's programs that write programs. So,
wait, Sam, can you just give a really quick introduction to Racket for anyone who doesn't know?
Racket is the best programming language. That's all really all the introduction you need. Racket is the best programming language because it's the programming language you can use metaprogramming to turn into your favorite programming language. It's a language that's descended from Lisp and Scheme. It's been developed by a bunch of crazy academics like me for the past 25 years. And it's used for a variety of things in education, research, building websites that sell you tea, and everything in between. The thing you're seeing on my screen is the IDE that comes with Racket, which is called Dr. Racket. And it has some special features that can help you understand and write macros, that is metaprograms, and figure out what it is that your programs are doing. So that's the basics of Racket. There's one other thing that's really important to know about Racket, and that is that every program in Racket starts with a line that tells you what language you're programming in. And you can see that line right here at the top. It says that this program is written in the Racket language. That's the default language that we use, but you can choose lots of other options. So let's get started. Here's a Racket program. It's very exciting. When I click the run button, Dr. Racket will run it, and we see that we get 5. Now let's write a metaprogram to generate this program for us, because why write a simple program when you can write a complicated program that generates your simple program? So let's get started.
Dun, 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 dun.
This program, you'll be shocked to know, also prints 5, but it's much easier to understand because we used metaprogramming. So just to show you how easy to understand this is, let's go through it. The keyword define syntax here tells us that we're creating a new piece of syntax. And what we're defining is called simple. And simple is a function that takes an argument, which we'll not worry about for the moment, and it produces something. And what it produces is 5. Of course, it doesn't just produce 5. It produces a program that contains 5. That to create a program, we want to construct a new AST for our program. And the way we construct ASTs is with this funny syntax here with a hash and then a quote. So we could write that out without quite so many sigils by writing it this way. So this says we're going to construct the syntax for the number 5. And then when we run it, we get the number 5 because we reference the simple program right here. So that's our very first metaprogram. Now let's write something that's a little more interesting. parentheses. They're very annoying. Here we have a more interesting program, and I'll use it, and then I will explain what it does. And then, after I explain what it does, I'll explain the line that I just wrote. So my if works just like if. So true is true, and it produces one. So my if works just like if. Now let's talk about what it is that I wrote. So here's my definition of my if. Again, I use define syntax to say that I'm defining a macro. Then what I did was I wrote a pattern. I used a pattern matcher called syntax parse to look at the program that I wrote, which is our input AST called syntax. And if it looks like my if followed by a test, and then a then, and then an else, then we're going to generate, using this syntax constructor, a conditional that says if the test is true, then do the then, otherwise do the else. Now, one thing that's notable here is that I reference test, then, and else here. So the Racket macro system and pattern matching system comes with a lot of convenient features for writing things in a short way. So I can just write down this pattern and turn it into this, what's called a template to construct an AST very easily. But I could also write this just using more basic AST manipulation. And I can, Jean, are you waving at me?
No, there's an audience question.
Sorry, I can't see the Twitch
chat. Yeah. That's why I went like this.
Okay.
But multiple people asked, what if TST was not a value? And then I will, while we're asking questions, I'll ask another one, which is, why, how is this different? How is this special with macros? Why couldn't you do this with just functions?
That is a great question.
But that one was not an audience question, so we should do the audience.
I'll answer the audience question. What if the test is not a value? Well, we'll just check whether a random number from 0 to 19 is even. And let's see. Well, it wasn't even that time. It was even that time. So sometimes it's even and sometimes it's not. Let's see. Now let's answer Jean's question. I'll start by changing this program in a way that doesn't do anything different. So I'm just, instead of producing a value, I'm going to print out the value. So now you see yes, now you see no. But what happens if I had written this as a function to answer Jean's question of why would you write a macro for this at all? So here's the same program, but written as a function. Now let's rewrite this as to use Jean's if. And we see that it prints both yes and no. And that's because Jean if is a function. That means we're going to compute the random number, and whether it's even, we're going to print yes and print no all before we get to running the function. So this brings up one of the basic uses of macros in any language, which is to change how things are evaluated. Here I've the myif takes some expressions and puts them into interesting places like under a conditional. And it does that without evaluating them. So it constructs a new program where things may or may not be evaluated or might appear in other interesting places in your constructed program. So that's many of the basics of macros in Racket, but I just want to show off what we can do to make our lives even easier using macros. So many of the things that you're looking at here are built with macros themselves. That's what we've done with this syntax/parse library, which I had to import. That's because the pattern matcher I'm using, called syntax parse, that's not built into the language. That's itself built as a macro. And I can use more things that are built as macros, more abstractions, to make the macros that I write even easier. So here's a simpler version of myif. And now we're done. And that's all you need to do to be able to write a macro, a simple abbreviation like myif in Racket. So that's the basics. And now we'll turn things over to Quinn to show off the basics in Elixir.
Awesome. Cool. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Sam. And then I will bookmark some audience comments and questions here to return to, because I do not feel that these will be their comments and questions by the end of this metaprogram off. So one person said, are macros just what you use when your compiler fails you? And I think that, you know, you guys will address this. And then another person asked, why is metaprogramming more useful here, say, than computation types or thunks? Is it purely syntactic? And again, I think the rest of the metaprogram off will address these questions. So I'm just calling them out. And then we will continue now with Quinn.
Yep. The first examples I show are not going to answer the first question, but I think we have some demonstrations later on that will show the value of metaprogramming.
Some challenges.
Yes, some challenges. Okay. In theory, you should be able to see my screen now. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yes.
All right.
You might want to increase your font, though.
Yeah, I'll do that. Is this better?
Perfect.
Awesome. So Sam covered a lot of the basics, so I'm not going to repeat too much of what he said, but I do want to just touch on a couple points. First off, as he said, metaprogramming is writing code that writes code. But the way I like to think of it is basically an alternate reality, where in your regular code, you're writing code that operates on values within the language. Those might be integers or strings or lists, things like that. But then when you're in this fancy metaprogramming alternate world, you're now writing functions that operate on syntax within the language to produce new syntax that gets injected into the program. In the case of Elixir and Racket, this happens at compile time. So as Sam showed, this can be used to create new control flow structures, to generate code from data, and so on. And even though that sounds really complicated and really abstract, both Elixir and Racket give you some really cool tools to make it a bit easier. So I've set up a project on the left here to act as a scratch pad for some of the stuff I'll be doing today. And first off, I'll just show off some of the Elixir equivalents of the tools Sam showed off. The first one is quoting. Quoting lets you turn code as code into code as data, as I like to think of it. So as a simple example, if we wanted to see what the abstract syntax tree looked like for 1 + 2, we could just quote that. And that would return what the node looks like in the AST in Elixir. Now, if you look at this closely, you might recognize that this looks kind of like an S expression. I can't remember if Sam mentioned S expressions when he was talking, but they're basically the foundation of how Lisp works. You have these lists of values, and typically the first value is some sort of function or operation. And then the other values are the arguments to that function or operation. Elixir works very similarly, except every AST node is basically this triple of three values, where the first one is some sort of function or operation or control flow construct or whatever. The second one is some metadata about the node. And then the third one is the list of arguments to it. So as you can see here, quote makes it very easy to go from the Elixir syntax to the AST, which is going to be very useful later on when we start writing some macros. Now, similarly, there is unquote, which you can use to turn an AST node back into code itself. So if we wanted to see what that looks like, we could just basically do the same thing. And we could unquote the AST we produced, put it back into a quote block, and this is basically going to null off and give us back what we did before. Another useful tool is the ability to actually evaluate these ASTs. So if I pass that into here, 1 + 2 = 3, nothing super exciting there. And lastly, you can turn a syntax tree back into the actual Elixir code that maps to. In this case, it's 1 + 2. So since Sam showed off how to make your own if statements, I'm going to do the same thing here. In Elixir, you define macros with def macro. And macros, again, are basically functions, but instead of turning values into values, they turn abstract syntax trees into abstract syntax trees. And then those get injected into the call site. So in this case, we're going to have a macro that takes a predicate, a named argument named block, and another named argument named else. Those are going to be the two branches of the if statement. Now, just for demonstration purposes, I'm also going to output the values of these when the macro is called. And then we are able to basically return a quoted block, which is going to, again, get turned back into an AST and then injected into the call site. So just like Sam did in his example, we're going to have a cont construct, which, if you're not familiar, is basically a list of clauses. And the clauses are walked down, and then the first one that evaluates to true is executed. So we're essentially going to turn the predicate back into code so that that will get evaluated. We're going to check whether the result is either nil or false. If that's the case, we're going to run the otherwise block. And then otherwise, we're just going to fall back to the true block. So that is the entire macro here. I'm going to restart my shell. And then if we wanted to actually use this, we can import that macro. Sorry, import the module, which will import the macros that are defined inside of it. Go ahead, Jim.
Quinn, really quick question from the audience. How often do you have to explicitly quote and unquote in Elixir with macros?
There are places where the quote is implicit, and that's something you're going to see in one of the upcoming examples. There are also some pieces of syntactic sugar you can use to avoid having to explicitly unquote. So here, for example, I can do bind unquoted, and then I can give the list of all of the terms that I would like to use within the unquote, or sorry, within the quote. And then these will now automatically be unquoted for me. And the compiler will also error if I try to unquote anything that wasn't explicitly listed here. So for complicated macros, that can be really nice for cleaning things up. But generally, somewhere along the line, something is going to have to quote or unquote things unless you're manually writing the ASTs, which you can do, and I have done. But for the most part, these tools make it easy to avoid having to do that yourself. Yeah, so we have imported the macro down here. Now we can evaluate it. So I'm going to check if 5 is less than 10. If so, I am going to say that all is well with the world. And if that's not the case, then oh no, something's gone terribly wrong. Cool, all is well with the world. But here we also output a couple other things. That's because here I was actually printing the values of the arguments to this macro, because what I wanted to demonstrate here is that what's being passed in isn't values as we normally think of them in Elixir. These are AST nodes representing the arguments that we pass to the macro. So in the case of the if argument, we got a tuple that is the less than operator applied to 5 and 10. For the do block, we got a block of code that is a little bit difficult to read here, but it is essentially opening up a scope and then calling the io.puts function with all is well with the world. And the same thing is happening for the else clause. So now I'm not going to retype all of that again because that's tedious, but just to show this off, we could quote that same if statement that we ran before, and this would return the AST representing code in the Elixir source file. And then we would be able to use that macro.toString helper I showed you before to see what this expands out to. And I need to also call macro.expand here, which is going to walk that syntax tree, look for any macros, and then expand them. And I need to pass in a list of bindings for that. So in this case, that's empty. Oops. Okay, something has gone terribly wrong, but I don't want to debug it while I'm live here. So you just have to take my word for it that it is possible to expand these macros and evaluate them. Oh, there we go, okay. So that if statement evaluated to our cont expression that checks if 5 is less than 10 by seeing whether that is either new or false, then following that to the other branch in the other case. Yeah, so that's kind of a whirlwind tour of macros that kind of mirrors everything that Sam talked about. I don't know if anyone had questions in the chat that I should address before we move on to anything else.
I guess I had a follow-up question, which was maybe just a slightly spicy question is, and this is really for both of you, is do you feel like, you know, Racket, given that it's essentially based on Scheme and Lisp, that there's an advantage in developer friendliness because the code is essentially the same as like any piece of data? So like the AST is essentially like a bunch of lists.
Yeah, I am sure Sam has a great answer for this. I'm tempted to let him go first, if that works for you. Okay.
Sure. So I think the answer is that S expressions are sort of an advantage and a disadvantage in this. So the advantage is that I can build any kind of syntax that I want that looks like any other form in my language using macros. I don't have to constrain myself to particular parts of the syntax. And you do see that constraint in something like Elixir, where basically macros all have to look like a function call. At least I think that was what was going on here, Quinn. And similarly, other languages with macros that don't use S expressions like Rust, again, macros have to basically look like a function call, or there are maybe a few other particular places where you can write macros.
We'll see some examples of that soon, but for the most part, that's the case.
In Racket, you're going to have the ability to make your macros look like any other part of the language. The drawback of that is that all the parts of your language have parentheses in them. And the reason that you can write macros that look like any other part of your language is that all the parts of your language follow the same very basic structure with parentheses and prefix notation. And so if you are okay with that syntax, then it's a great advantage for macros. But you have to be okay with that syntax. There's lots of ways in Racket, and I'll show some of them, where you can have different syntaxes, but that's really the big pro and con for S expressions.
That answer actually really mirrors what I was going to say, which is that Racket and Lisp and all of these metaprogramming languages are incredibly powerful, but their syntax turns a lot of people off. And I'm going to paraphrase a quote here from Chris McCord. He's an Elixir developer who wrote the Phoenix web framework, if you've heard of that. And he likes to say that Jose, who made Elixir, basically his big revolution with Elixir was to take the S expressions of Lisp and Racket and so on, but then layer on a high-level syntax for that so that you have a programmable AST, but then also a high-level syntax for when you don't need that. And for someone like me, this has been huge in terms of making metaprogramming accessible. I've been writing Elixir for about 8 years now, and it's only in the past couple of years that I've actually started writing my own macros. But prior to that, I've been able to depend on macros written by library authors who are making use of these capabilities to write really powerful DSLs and libraries that I'm able to take advantage of without needing to drop down to those S expressions or worry about the AST or understand these more complicated aspects of the language. And I think that's a really powerful idea in terms of exposing these concepts to a greater audience.
Cool, thanks.
I just want to note that it blows my mind that you've been writing Elixir for 8 years.
I started in college and then I dropped out and did a startup in Elixir.
Sam, what's like the ballpark number of years you've been writing Racket?
So if we, Racket, so I guess 22 now.
Wow.
You either started when you're six or you're a lot older than I thought you were.
Well, if we want to go back to when I started writing Scheme, it would be 26. So
wow.
Sam is at least 27.
Yeah, so I'm at least 27. And if you think I'm 27, then I'm not going to disabuse you of that.
I'm happy to not be disabused.
Cool. So there was one audience question about hygiene, like hygienicness in the macros. And then once we do that question, we should move on to round two.
Oh, that is an excellent question. So Elixir macros are hygienic by default. If you don't know what that means, it basically means that by default, macros cannot depend on the state of the color. So if we want to see a concrete example of that, I can make a quote block that does x plus one, and then I can it's code.eval quoted. If I try to evaluate this AST with x set to 5, it's actually going to fail because it's trying to evaluate x as a function, and it's not recognizing that x is actually a variable with the value set to 5. But if I were to rewrite this a little bit, and I really hope I have the syntax right for this, then now we have explicitly said that x is going to be a variable from the color's context. And in theory, when I evaluate that, it's going to evaluate to 6 under a binding of x mapped to 5. And just like this var bang construct, there are similar constructs for accessing imports and aliases and so on. So by default, macros are generally very safe, and you don't run into the sorts of problems you see in a language like Ruby, where you're at risk of the metaprogramming facilities kind of bleeding into the rest of the application and changing the language out from underneath you. Things are very controlled in the way that macros are written in Elixir. And as a result, I think the community feels much safer about taking advantage of macros when they're helpful.
Cool. Thanks. Yeah, I was wondering what the second part of the output was. That makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Well, so if there are no other words for this round, we will move on to the next round because we've got 21 minutes and two more rounds.
Yes.
We got to hurry a bit. Should I just take this one for now since I'm already sharing?
Why don't you're going to do a demo?
This round is the using macros for fun and profit, mostly profit. So this round is about showing how macros can be used for things that you might want to do in your everyday programming.
Yep.
Cool. Awesome. So for the most part, I am a web developer. I work on a lot of web applications. And something that I have had to deal with a lot on in my day-to-day work is dealing with MIME types and converting between MIME types and their corresponding extensions and so on. The example that I'm going to show you, I cannot take credit for. This is the technique used by Plug, which is a built-in or semi-built-in HTTP framework for Elixir. but I'm basically going to show you how to auto-generate a library from a database of mime types that will then be able to convert between mime types and their extensions and in the other order or in the other direction. So just to start, I have this file prepared here, mime.types, which is basically a list of a few thousand mime types and the extensions that they map to. And from this, I would like to generate a library that can do these mappings automatically. Now, when I'm writing macros in Elixir or in any other language, really, I think it's really important to think about the code that you're generating and what you'd like it to look like. So I always start by manually creating a sample of the code I'd like to end up with. I thought I had pasted this here, but I didn't. So let's do that. So basically, I'm going to want to generate a module that has two different functions in it. Extension to type, which takes an extension and maps to the mime type. This is basically a lookup table, if you're not familiar with the syntax. It's going to walk down the function heads until it finds an argument that matches and then return that result with a fallback of nil. And I'd also like a function that maps an extension to the list of, or sorry, maps a type to the list of extensions that that type maps to. Let's see, I'm going to expand this window a little bit and put the, oops, and put this over to the side. And yeah, let's see what this looks like. I am not going to implement this line by line, but I am going to walk through the result. So this is an example of one of the cases where we don't need to explicitly deal with quoting and unquoting so much, because a useful quality of Elixir is that when you're within a module, any top-level code that isn't within a function declaration is kind of in an implicit quote block, and it's evaluated at compile time. So this means that you can perform computation at compile time and use that to generate functions from data and so on. So here I first set this annotation saying that that file I showed you on the right is an external resource. This basically tells the compiler that this module depends on this file and that if this file changes, this module also needs to be recompiled. This has been used in a ton of Elixir libraries to do things like have CMSs that generate the site statically and recompile your site as the markdown files change and so on. But then from here, I just start writing some code. So I stream this file, I get rid of all the lines that are comments or have new lines at the beginning. And then I just split those and separate the line into the type and the extensions. I filter that to remove all of the lines that don't have any extensions associated with them. And then I'm literally just doing a list comprehension over that mapping and dynamically defining a function head for each of the mappings in that file. I do the same thing in the other direction for type two extensions. And then the end result, which I'm just going to recompile down. I'm going to recompile down here so you can see that. This file takes a little bit to compile because it's reading that file and doing all that work at compile time. But I'm now able to pass in, say, JSON as an extension, and it'll get application.json because that's what it had found in the file. Similarly, I can go from, say, and that'll return the list of file extensions. This is a really basic example, but I think this is an incredibly powerful technique because it really allows you to generate code from data in a way that removes a couple failure points from your system. The first most obvious one is that with this technique, you're basically statically linking against data. So there's no longer a risk of files not existing wherever you're deploying them. You don't have to worry about failing to read that file at runtime, it getting renamed, whatever. But where this really shines, I think, is when you are able to specify the behavior of your program using data so that you can derive the implementation from that data. And I think the best example of this, and one of the reasons that Elixir is so mind-blowing to me, is that it does exactly this for its Unicode implementation. I don't think I would be wrong in saying that Elixir has the best Unicode support of any language. And the way it does this is by using exactly this technique to create in a database of all of the possible Unicode code point conversions so that it can generate its code for its handling of Unicode to handle composition and decomposition of graphemes and downcasing and upcasing of graphemes. And basically any transformation you would want to perform on a Unicode string is generated at compile time from a specification of those transformations. As the Unicode spec changes, Elixir's code changes with it, and you don't need to worry about these really error-prone and manual modifications to a really complicated behemoth of a feature like that. There's another really cool Elixir library that generates a client for the Chrome Remote DevTools protocol from the specification of that protocol. And like, as you can see here, it's not difficult to apply this technique. If you have data that describes what you want to do, you can use this without understanding macros or ASTs or anything like that, and your code's going to be more maintainable for it. I don't want to harp on that too long. I don't know if Sam has anything else to add, but I just think this example is so cool.
Yeah, no, this is an awesome demonstration.
I totally agree with all of that. Because this is such a great example of how you can leverage metaprogramming to make your programs work better, I'll just briefly show off the same example in Racket, and you can see just how things look similar and how things look different. Interface will be a little different, but we'll see. So here we have this MIME code. So we've got a few pieces. I've saved this, the same file that Quinn is using in here, and we're gonna get a bunch of lines broken on by new lines. And then I'm going to iterate over all of the elements of that line and match them against a regular expression. And the format of this file is we've got a MIME type, which is A through Z with slashes and dashes, some white space, and then another file extension. And I'm only going to consider things when this is true. If it produces false, that means we had a comment or something else. And then I'm going to just look at the remaining components of this match, which are these two groups. So either that's a MIME type followed by the empty string because there's no extension. And I'm going to say we're going to construct a hash called mapping that maps A to, that is the MIME type to false, otherwise A to B. And I'm also going to construct a reverse mapping, which just goes back from all of the extensions that we found to all of the mappings. But I'm not just doing that to produce these mappings. I'm doing that inside a block where I wrote down begin for syntax. So this is all going to happen at compile time. And then I've got a very short macro that is just going to allow me to define two identifiers, one of which is the forward mapping and one of which is the backward mapping. So our syntax is going to take two identifiers for forward and backward, and then we're going to define ID to be the mapping and define RID to be the reverse mapping. And then here's my definition. And then we can look up text HTML and HTML. And when we run it, we get the results we expected. One thing that is worth, a couple things worth pointing out here. One is just that metaprogramming is really all about doing the sorts of computation that you would do regularly, except doing it at compile time. And that's really explicit here because we're just taking some regular Racket programs. I actually developed this without the begin for syntax, of course. And then we can take programs that work normally, and then run them at compile time and use the results to produce the kind of code that we want. The other thing that's important is to see what Quinn was talking about with hygiene. Let's change this a little bit. We're gonna not provide the X's name. Now you might think that this would just define the identifier RID instead. So what happens when I type in RID? It says it's undefined. It doesn't exist there. So I'm going to now show off a neat feature of Racket in which I'm just going to click this button called Macro Stepper, and it's going to show the expansion of my program. Here's MIMES. It turned into this giant hash. And then here's RID. But the important thing to know about this is that this RID isn't going to be the same as another RID that I had written down in my program. So if I wrote RID down here, I get that gets Dr. Racket tells me that didn't work. That's an unbound identifier. And it will, and that's what we mean by hygiene, that we, the fact that this RID appears near where we used the macro doesn't interfere with the names that we used inside the macro, and vice versa. So that's a different, slightly different way of doing the same sorts of basic ideas. And this really does come in handy for all sorts of tasks when you have to deal with data and ingest that data into your program.
Awesome. No, this is super, super cool. And in the discussion afterward, I love that the challenges have such similar examples, and they're becoming even more similar because this will be great for the discussion afterward. Mm-hmm. Yeah, in the interest of time, we're going to run a little bit over. So for all of the audience who needs to go and doesn't, you know, wants to know the outcome of the metaprogram off, we're not going to get it right at noon or yeah, what 3 p.m. PT or ET. Yes. I'm really bad at time zones.
Different time zones. Sorry.
Yeah, yeah. We're not going to get a result in 7 minutes because we have a last round, and we're actually really excited about this round. The last round is things you can do with building your own developer and language level tooling with metaprogramming. And this is very, very cool. So we want to not rush this. And so I'm Sam, since I guess in the tradition of the person who last went going first again, do you want to do your metaprogram? Yeah, meta tools, sure. Overtime. Yeah.
Yes. Sudden death, something, something.
Okay, so I want to show off two different things, and then I think in this one, Quinn will show off some things that are different instead of us doing exactly the same thing. So the first thing I want to show off is what one thing you can do by changing this language line. And I'm going to change it to my favorite version of the language line, which is called typed racket. Racket, being a descendant of Lisp and Scheme, is not usually a language with types, but we can use metaprogramming to make it a language with types. And here's typed racket. Let's try running this program. So far, everything looks the same, but when I type this, we know that X is an integer, and if I make a mistake, people make this mistake all the time. We actually get a type error message that you can see down at the bottom of my screen that it expected a number and got a string. And this happens all at compile time, and it's driven entirely by the by a set of fundamentally macros that I've written that are brought in by switching this line from Racket to typed Racket. And you can build a full typed language with all of the things, many of the things that you'd expect from type languages like polymorphism, type inference, and many more. One particular thing that I want to mention here is that typed Racket is also a language with macros. It's not just a language built with macros. So we can write, let's make our program work again. We can write a macro. So here's a not very interesting macro, but our uses of our macro are going to get type checked. And we can see that it in fact highlights this use of my macro and says that it has a type mismatch. So we can write macros and our resulting program is still type checked, and that's all actually implemented in the macro system. So those are some cool features. And just to demonstrate a little bit of how that works, here's a somewhat simpler language. This is the X language. It just has a few what are called combinators. Combinators are an idea invented by some mathematicians thinking about the foundations of mathematics that fit in with pure functional programming. And turns out you can express everything with a small number of combinators called S and K, or even just the combinator X. So this language just has those things plus numbers in it, but you can write some programs in it nonetheless. And here's a program that just produces 4. Not super exciting, but let's open up the implementation. So this is the entire implementation of that language. There's nothing else. So it says, here are the things that are available in the language. There's modules, there's a REPL, there's function application, there's quoted data, and there's X, K, S, and I, which are defined here. And here's the infrastructure to connect it to that hash lang line. Saying that if you use this, then we're going to use the pltalk/X module to determine how the language works. And with no other specifications, it uses the basic S expression syntax. But I could provide a whole set of additional procedures here to determine how we go from a character stream to an AST. And so that means we can entirely customize the written syntax, the lexical syntax of the language. And we have lots of languages that do that in the Racket family as well, ranging from the Scribble documentation tool to a version of Datalog that uses the regular old data log syntax. So that's a quick demonstration of what's possible with language customization in Racket. You can go get everything from a combinator basis language to a full typed version of Racket.
Hey Sam, I was curious, how does the typed Racket, how is the implemented? Because you mentioned it's also just a macro or a set of macros, right?
Yeah. So if we have another 10 or 12 hours, then I can just walk through the implementation here. So the basic idea is that the language, the Racket lets you provide a macro that gets wrapped around the entire module. And Typed Racket does that. And then what it does is it expands all of the things in your module to the core low-level forms. And then there's just a regular type checker that walks over that program in those core low-level forms and runs a type checker of the kind that you can learn about in lots of the other PL talk episodes.
Okay, cool, thanks.
Cool. So Sam, did you also want to show your other thing now?
I want to let Quinn go now.
Oh yeah, it's
okay. Great. Yes, time for the rebuttal.
Yes, I appreciate that. So I think you need to stop sharing before I can take over.
Oh yes, there we go.
Dun 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 dun.
Okay.
Do 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 dramatic music.
All right, so I'm going to demonstrate something similar to Typed Racket, but with a little bit of a different end goal. Elixir, like Racket, is dynamically typed. I'm someone who absolutely loves types, so this is my biggest complaint about the language. But fortunately, no, Alexa, I'm not talking to you. But fortunately, with the help of macros, I'm able to, in some way, get around some of the limitations of dynamic typing where I need to. So what I'm going to show you now is a small example that I have put together based on an open source library named Norm by Chris Keefley. Sorry, one second, music just turned playing. I'd hate to get the stream banned because Alexa started playing music. Anyway, where was I? So yeah, Chris Keefley wrote a library called Norm, which basically implements Eiffel-style contract-driven development, if you've ever seen that. So again, as always, I when writing macros, start with an example of what I would like the finished syntax to look like. And what we're going to do here is extend the language with this contracts module that allows us to add annotations above functions like this that allow us to specify the types of functions, including their arguments and return value. And then at compile time, we'd like this to expand out to runtime checks that verify that these pre and post conditions hold so that arguments are actually of the type that we expect and the return value is also of the type that we expect. Now, Norm does a lot more than this, but because we only have a couple minutes here, I'm going to implement a small sample of what's possible with this library. And in this case, this is approximately what I think this syntax should expand out to. So in the case of this even function here, we'd like it to basically wrap the function body so that it adds a guard at the top that checks that n is an integer, returning an error if not. And then doing the same thing for the return result to verify that it's actually returning a Boolean. Now, in the interest of time, I have made like a skeleton module that we're going to fill in some of the gaps in, but we're not going to show all of the lines of code because there is about 100 lines here. Just to help out a little bit, I defined a custom exception here that's trying to capture how we return the error messages. It takes an MFA, which is Elixir terminology for basically a tuple of a module, a function name, and an arity. That's typically how we represent functions. And so that's just going to get rendered as like module.functionName/the number of arguments that it takes. All right, let's get implementing. I'm going to stick this over here just so you can see what the goal looks like. And then I'm going to come over here. So let's look at what we have first. At the start, we have this macro called __using. This is a special macro in Elixir that gets run when you use a module like this over here. It basically runs this block, possibly passing options to it, And then the AST that gets returned gets injected into the call site. So this is a really convenient way for libraries to set up any preliminary work that needs to happen in order to support the other macros that that library enables. At the start, I just unexport the built-in at symbol function so that we can replace it with our own custom one. And then I am also going to register what's called a module attribute, which is in a sense kind of like a variable that we can use at compile time so that we're able to accumulate all these contracts that we're defining and then generate some code from them. Then lastly, I just define a before compile callback, which is going to tell any of the modules that use this module that right before they finish compiling, they should run this function here. And this is where we're going to do the work of actually iterating over all of these contracts that we've accumulated and then generating our new wrapped functions that have those starts. We then also define a macro for dealing with this at contract syntax. We're going to show what that looks like. And whenever we are calling that at macro with anything else, we're just going to fall back to the built-in one because we want to be good citizens and we don't want to overwrite the base language here. I am not going to spend too much time here, but these functions are how we parse this line. If you're curious, the way that you can come up with this fancy looking invocation here is by using that quote function I've talked about before. What's always helpful is to paste the syntax that you want to be able to handle into quote to see what the syntax tree looks like. So in this case, the argument to contract here is going to be a list where the first element is a list of the arguments and their types. N is an integer. And the second element is going to be the return value. So basically, I'm just using these functions to destructure this AST and pull out the name of the function that we're defining a contract for, the types of its arguments, the number of arguments, and then the type of the return result. So let's start filling in some of these functions. The first one I want to talk about is assert type. This is basically where we're going to take the type of the argument that we've defined and expand that out to a guard that verifies that the value is of that type. We're cheating a little bit here because Elixir has built-in functions for checking whether a variable is any of the types that we care about, and they all follow the same form. So for example, if you wanted to check if something is an integer, you would call isInteger on it. So because we're only supporting the primitive types here, we can determine the name of the guard that we want to call by just using the type that we have defined in the contract. And now we're going to call that function using the value that we were given. And basically, if it doesn't come back as true, we're going to raise that error that we defined. The things that we have here so we can construct a nice error message. So let's implement def macro at contract here. This is where we're going to want to parse that contract line over here so that we can add it to that module attribute that we defined. And in this case, we already have that parse function defined. So we can just call that with everything. Destructuring everything that we care about. That function is called parse contract. And we are just going to pass the expression here that is the argument to the contract. Now, in order to define a module attribute, we can call at with contracts here. Again, we're falling back to the default implementation. So this is just going to append this tuple to that module attribute, and we'll be able to use it later on. We're in a quote block here, so I'm going to unquote all of the things that we have parsed out. And the end result here is that now every time we call one of these, it's going to parse that line and toss it into a module attribute that we're going to be able to later handle. Where we handle that is going to be inside this before compile function. Again, this is the last thing that is called before the module is compiled. So at this point, we know all the contracts have been parsed. We can just get that attribute, which will give us all of the contracts that we parsed. And now we can just iterate over all of them and do something with them. So I'm going to use a comprehension, iterate over everything. And then we're going to call that wrap function that we are defining next. So here we're going to pass in that MFA that I talked about. That's used for error reporting. We're going to pass in the types of all the arguments, and we're going to pass in the result type. This is going to return an AST, which is what we actually want to inject into the call site. What is this subset that I need to remove the underscore there? So now the last thing that's left to implement is wrap function. This is a function that's going to take all that data we just collected and basically define a new function that wraps the original with all of our guards. There's a little bit of setup that we need to do here. For the MFA, we need to call macro.escape. This is a function that you can use to introduce a new node into the AST. The MFA wasn't already in the AST, so we call that here. We're also going to call this generate arguments function, which gives us a list of AST nodes representing the arguments to the function. We generate as many as there are arguments to the function. And now we can generate that function itself. So first off, we call this def overridable thing. This tells us that the function that we're passing in, which this is again the name of the function, and the array is the number of arguments. That's how functions are named in Elixir. We're saying that this is an overridable function. So that'll give us access to the super keyword so we can call the original. And now we're going to generate an AST node for the function that we are trying to generate. Unquote splicing basically just takes this list of arguments and we'll turn them into a comma-separated list of nodes, like in a function definition. And then now for the implementation of this function, we can basically just call these other functions that we've defined for asserting types. So assert arguments takes the MFA and the archetypes, along with the actual arguments that were passed in. And we can call the function. We can use super here because we've defined this function as overridable. We can then call assert type on the result of the function. And then we can just return the result. So now, assuming I have done everything correctly, which is a big if, I called this that wrong. So assuming I called this all correctly, we should be able to call these example functions we defined. If we pass in two, it works. If we pass in true, it's now a runtime error with a nice error message about what went wrong. Similarly, if we call broken odd with say two, it works as you expect because when it's even, it returns false. But if we pass in an odd number, it returns true as a string, and that's now a runtime error. So this is just a small sample of the sorts of functionality that you can create with macros. And the library that I base this example on, Norm, does far more. It hooks all this up with a property testing library, so you can automatically generate example inputs for functions so that you can then property test them really easily. And things like that. But this is super cool. We did this in basically 100 lines and basically copied Eiffel's contract-driven development features without having to modify the base language at all. Does anyone have questions about any of that? I kind of rambled for a while.
There were some questions in the chat, but then I think other people in the chat answered them.
Okay.
So if people still have live unanswered questions, please say them again. But yeah, no, Quinn, that was really, really cool. Thank you.
I covered a lot of ground there. So if that didn't all make sense to you, that's fine. This uses almost every feature in some capacity.
Yeah, no, this is incredible. Yeah, and I think in case people missed it in the chat, Quinn's gonna, she's gonna put the repos for the code somewhere. And then in the Discord, say something about it.
Yeah. And I also have a list of really cool examples of macros in Elixir that I'll post to.
Yeah.
They show up everywhere in the language, but as a user, you don't necessarily see all that work because, again, the way the syntax is set up means that it's mostly library authors who need to drop down to this level.
Yeah, so this is super cool. So it turns out Hongi has to go very soon. So we have to do the judgment very quickly. So if you'll recall, everyone, this is a meta program off, and we've seen three rounds of they've been more similar than we expected.
Yeah, I was gonna say that. Round one was like intros. Round two was what are everyday use cases? Like, why would people use the languages for macros? And round three was what are some of the ways you can use macros to develop new features? Right.
Yep.
Cool.
And so Hongi, you're supposed to be the one who does this judgment.
I know, this is really tough. I was going to say
it's only our lives on your
hands. Yeah, Twitch lives. We never determine exactly the meaning of a Twitch life, but.
I was going to agree with you and say it feels like there are clearly like trade-offs, right, with each one and in different ways. I think at the same time, they definitely feel a lot more similar than I expected, I think, initially. So I don't know. I don't know if I can make a judgment.
Well,
that's not biased.
No talk, we do type judgments all the time.
Yeah, people in the chat are really pushing for something. Well, I think how about this? We don't necessarily have to make a judgment, but we need to make a proclamation about what needs to happen across the two meta program offers going forward.
Wait, what?
Well, I think the audience wants to see something happen. So we promise that,
you want blood.
The loser was going to have to implement the winner's language in macros in their language. And so
we could do both. I think that would actually be kind of interesting.
Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. This is so dramatic. So in a dramatic turn of events. Hongi has concluded that the two macro systems are more similar than he expected. And so everyone loses.
Everyone loses.
Everyone loses. Oh boy.
On the way.
And so now the sentence.
Everyone gets punished.
Both Quinn and Sam have to implement each other's languages in using the macros of their own language.
So I'm implementing Lisp and Sam is implementing the Beam VM.
I think
I made up the victor here.
Yeah, I think there's a loser here. Someone said we should ask Alexa too, just to make sure. But cool. So I think Hongi does have to go, but
other punishment was that the loser had to tweet about how awesome the metaprogramming features
were. So it sounds like both of you also have to tweet about how awesome
the metaprogramming. So I think we both have to tweet about how cool the metaprogramming features
are. I can do that.
That's right.
Yeah.
I'm willing to concede that Racket is amazing.
Yeah, so I think both of you have to do those tweets. This is a good outcome. So I think Hongi has to go, but if Quinn and Sam have a few minutes, I'd actually love to just hear your thoughts on the metaprogramming systems in the other language. And I think that, we all or maybe you guys knew this, but Hongyi and I were actually quite surprised by how similar the metaprogramming systems were. I think my biggest previous experience was with the Haskell metaprogramming system, which is quite different. So I would love a little bit of discussion on, you know, was this what you two expected, Quinn and Sam? How does this compare to other metaprogramming systems? What is the lineage? Like, you know, was Elixir inspired by Racket? Is this how it happened? Or, you know, like there's just many questions I have.
Yeah. In terms of lineage, sorry.
Bye, Hongyi.
Yeah, thanks everyone.
Bye, Hongyi.
Thanks for the judgment.
Thank you so much. And no, thank you for all the live coding, because I know it's definitely scary. It's a very brave thing to do. So I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Yeah, so I just want to quickly address your last question about lineage. Unfortunately, that's an aspect of Elixir's history that I don't know the answer to offhand. With how similar Elixir system is to Lisp, I would be shocked if it's not a direct inspiration, but I can't say that for sure.
Yeah, from what I recall from hearing Jose talk about it, I'm pretty sure that Lisp and scheme macros were an inspiration for him. And certainly Hygiene was originally developed in the scheme community, and that's where that comes from. I guess I was less surprised than Hongyi about the similarity, because I've seen all the cool stuff that the Elixir people have been doing by adding Lisp style macros to their language and being able to build lots of awesome new tools using that. So definitely it's been, I guess, an exciting last 10 years now in metaprogramming. Lots of languages are now adopting serious macros. You see Elixir, you see Rust as two big examples of languages that have come up big in the last 10 years while also having a real metaprogramming system. And it's been cool to see that happen. And now it's not just a crazy Lisp parenthesis thing anymore.
Yeah, no, that's super cool. And Sam, I would love it if you gave just a little bit of insight onto, you know, like if this was people's first introduction to metaprogramming, what can they expect to be similar across metaprogramming systems and Rust and other languages, and what can they expect to be different?
Yeah, sure. So if you look at Rust, I think it's going to be broadly similar to Elixir. You're going to things are a little more distinguished in Rust. You can't make it look quite as exactly like a built-in language form, but similar, it looks mostly like a function call. You get pieces of syntax, you can quote and unquote and construct new pieces of syntax and build new abstractions in a similar way to Elixir. Jean, you mentioned metaprogramming in Haskell. That's a little different in that instead of writing macros that look sort of like existing programs, what you can do in Haskell is basically drop some switch to compile time in the middle of your program and write a program that produces an expression and just stick that in there. So that's sort of like what Quinn showed with code.val, I think. And you can effectively stick something that's going to be turned into a code object and then get spliced into the rest of your program. But you always have to keep working with these splices and thinking about multiple stages instead of having something that looks like it's natively integrated into your language the way you saw in all the examples that Quinn and I showed. And then you get lots of other forms of metaprogramming in other languages. Quinn mentioned Ruby, where you have a much more dynamic approach to metaprogramming, where instead of generating programs at compile time and then sticking them into your program and then compiling the whole thing, you're generating programs at runtime and then evaluating them at runtime. And much more so, the code happens at runtime and the evaluation happens at runtime as well.
Initially when I was advertising this metaprogram off, I had thought that was what Racket macros did, which is why I was like, we get this nice comparison of compile time and runtime. But yeah, maybe we should bring a Ruby macro person.
People do write programs like that. You can certainly use quote and quasi-quote to construct programs and then call eval in Lisp.
Yeah.
That's eval is a tricky tool to work with, and it's often much nicer to just generate the program that you want to run at compile time.
Cool. Yeah, there's now some enthusiasm for Ruby macros. Someone commended you on your diplomacy, Sam. There were a couple of more questions in the chat that if we want to answer here, it'd be great to do so. Someone brought up like C++ style macros. And that's a class of macros that we haven't mentioned yet. And so Sam or Quinn, I don't know if you want to talk about that relationship. And then real quick, someone also asked, why is template Haskell considered so bad? I feel like Sam, you might have some.
So I try to answer both of those questions. So C style macros, you basically get the sort of thing that I showed with defined syntax rule, except with a lot of buggy misfeatures. You get that, but it's harder to use and sometimes doesn't work. And you have to wrap things in single iteration while loops and that sort of thing. Then template Haskell, I think the big reason that template Haskell doesn't work is that macros involve evaluation, running a program at compile time. And that means that you have to be able to run your program inside your run your language inside your compiler. And that places a burden on your language implementation that can make life tricky. Both the Erlang VM that Elixir is built on and Scheme and Racket and other Lisp systems have always supported continuously evaluating new code. So it's easy to support the kind of evaluation during compilation that is fundamental to macros. But GHC wasn't architected that way and still isn't. And that makes metaprogramming kind of painful. You get, you end up in situations where like, it doesn't work if you cross compile and that sort of thing. So if you don't start with that attitude, it can be hard to build it in later.
Yeah, if anyone out there watching wants to do a template Haskell metaprogram off, and if anyone out there watching wants to do a Ruby one, I feel like then I'll finally get the static versus dynamic metaprogram off that I was originally trying to go for. I think that would be either terrible or very interesting, or both. So to end, it might be just really interesting for people to hear both from Quinn and Sam what you do with your macros day to day in your languages, and then also just like what do you use Elixir and Racket for respectively, just so you know, like a plug for your respective languages and not just the macro systems.
Yeah, I can tackle that a little bit. So first off, one of the main rules of metaprogramming is don't do it. So what that means is that oftentimes you're using libraries that use metaprogramming because it really is the best tool for the job. But in application code, there usually aren't as many opportunities to drop down to that level. That being said, some of the places where I have used it in my day-to-day job are doing things like auto-generating boilerplate for putting type annotations onto data models that map to database schemas, for example, or adding compile time checks for things like PubSub, for example. With PubSub, there's different topics that you might want to send messages over, and those topics might support different events. You would like consumers of those PubSub topics to be able to process those events asynchronously safely. If you were to write that manually, that is going to be a few dozen lines of boilerplate in Elixir to set up those supervision trees and pattern matching and verify that those topics actually exist and that they map to those event types that you're processing and so on. But with really lightweight DSLs, you could generate those supervision trees automatically that are going to make sure that improperly processing an event is not going to crash the rest of the system. And that sort of thing is generally where we end up making use of metaprogramming in application code. That being said, in libraries, it shows up everywhere, especially as you start getting into more advanced test frameworks for doing things like property testing.
Awesome. That's a great answer. Thank you, Quinn.
Yeah. So what I use macros all the time part of that is because much of my research is about doing that sort of thing. So implementing typed racket is something that I spend time doing, but also there's lots of macros that I've written to make my life easier when implementing other macros. So it's just macros all the way down. I've written lots of really hairy, complicated macros as a tool for writing other hairy, complicated macros. Whether that says something about Racket or about me or about macros, I'll let the audience judge. And what I do with Racket day to day, I do research and I teach with Racket, everything from graduate students to people who are just learning how to program. And then all the other programs that I write to manage everything else from visualizing data to running web services, I also write in Racket, just because that's me.
Awesome. Well, thank you both for this really, really cool metaprogram off. This was very experimental, but I love the live coding. People in the chat said, you know, they're really impressed with the volume of live coding. It was also awesome that you matched your demos to each other so well. Like, I think there was a really nice side-by-side comparison, better than my wildest dreams. And
Sam deserves a lot of credit for that, because I feel like you put together some of those demos late last night and this morning, based on what I had already had put together.
Yeah, so thank you, Sam. Thank you, Quinn. Yeah, thank you both for the extraordinary amount of prep and coordination you put into this metaprogram off. And I think this was a really, I don't know if it's a gentle introduction to macros. This was pretty much like, here are macros and here's like how to use every macro feature to do the most fancy thing you possibly can with macros. But hopefully people, have a deeper appreciation for macros and Sam and Quinn after this. So thank you everyone for coming.
Thank you for hosting us.
Yeah, no, this was very dramatic. Dun, 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 dun.
Dun, dun.
Yeah, I feel like I'm not a very good, like, dun, dun, dun singer. I'm practicing.
Sound effects.
Yeah. I feel like I watch other Twitch streamers and they have, like, the panel with all the sound effects and, like, the things. And I'm just like, this is a Zoom call, guys. Like, this is a Zoom call. so maybe I'll get one of those. Maybe, like, I got a new computer that's faster. So maybe I can get one of those, like, panels now. Nice. But for everyone who wants more PL Talk, we have a Discord, which I'll post a link to this chat. I'll post the schedule. Actually, the schedule has a link to the Discord, so this kills all the birds with one stone. Coming up, we have CF Bolts, who is one of the core PyPy Python JIT maintainers. He will be coming next week. It's also at a non-scheduled time of 2 p.m. Pacific. That was our compromise, but we're going to be talking about JITing Python. And then let me look at the schedule. We have after that, Rob O'Callaghan talking about time travel debugging. So Rob was one of the architects, if not the main architect on RR, the time travel debugger from Mozilla. And now he's working on a new debugger, Pronosco. So he will be coming March 5th. And then Yeah, the schedule says the other ones, but we have Arjun Guha talking about implementing continuations, call CC in JavaScript. We have John Regeer on fuzzing. We have Satnam Singh, who I believe is in the chat, talking about, you know, hardware verification and cock. And some of the stuff is like pretty practical sounding. So we'll see, we'll see. Hey Satnam, hey there. And then we have someone coming to talk about Amazon as Amazon's AWS Delcova for verifying IAM permissions. So yeah, thank you everyone for all the requests. We have a great schedule lined up in part thanks to that. And thanks everyone for the active chat. I think this one, I'm going to actually make a collage because there are some real gems in this chat. So, yeah, thank you, everyone, and see you in the Discord.
Peace, everyone. See you later.
Bye. Bye.